In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, amen. I'd like to welcome you all to our Perseverance Family Conversation this morning. It's great to be with all of you. And as always, we like to start off our conversation by inviting Mary to be with us. Mary has many wonderful titles. Mary is the Mother of God. Mary is the Mother of the Church. Mary is also the Queen of Apostles. Mary is the mother of each and every one of us. We also invoke Mary. In the prayer we say at the end of the Rosary, the Hail, Holy Queen. Mary is also our life, our sweetness, and our hope. So let's turn to Mary and ask Mary to pray with us and to pray for us. And we'll pray the prayer that she loves most, and that is the Ave Maria, the Hail Mary. Together. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Now we'd like to invite to be with us our spiritual director. Our spiritual director is the Holy Spirit. What a great privilege to have the Holy Spirit as our guide. Holy Spirit has many wonderful titles. Holy Spirit is known as the Paraclete. Holy Spirit is also known as the Gift of Gifts. Holy Spirit is also known as the Sweet Guest of Our Soul. Holy Spirit is also known as our Counselor. Counsel and consoler. Holy Spirit is also known as our interior master. St. Paul reminds us in his letter to the Romans that we're reading in the Mass as the first reading this week. In Romans chapter 8, that we really don't know how to pray as we ought. But the Holy Spirit intercedes with ineffable groans. So we can say, Abba. Abba, which means daddy or father. So let's ask the Holy Spirit to come and be with us. Beg the Holy Spirit to give us a lot of light, both light and fire. Light to enlighten our intellects, fire to set our hearts on fire with the love for God. As we pray, the classical prayer to the Holy Spirit, who's also known as the sweet guest of our souls. Together. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful. and enkindle within us the fire of your divine love. Send forth your spirit and they shall be created. Thou shalt renew the face of the earth. Let us pray. O God, who did instruct the hearts of your faithful by the light of the Holy Spirit, grant us that by the same Spirit we may be truly wise and ever rejoice in his consolation through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Our Lady, Queen of the Apostles, pray for us. Saint Joseph, pray for us. Saint Michael, pray for us. Saint Gabriel, pray for us. Saint Raphael, pray for us. Saint Simon, pray for us. Saint Jude, pray for us. Saint Ignatius of Loyola, pray for us. Saint Maria Faustina Kowalska, pray for us. All God's angels and saints, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. How true it is, my friends, the words of Father Peyton, the family that prays together, stays together. And a world at prayer is a world at peace. So as always, I will be praying for all of you. I have two wedding masses today, and I'll place you on the altar in these two masses. And I'll offer these specific intentions. One is I'd like to pray for all of us that we would be open to the workings of the Holy Spirit. Perhaps we can say this prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come through the heart of Mary. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come through the heart of Mary. My second intention, I'd like to pray for all of our family and family members that we would be converted to the love of God. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ said this, "What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul in the process?" My third intention will be, as always, I'd like to pray, my friends, for the dying. Throughout the world, there will be people that will be dying today. Are they well prepared? Perhaps many of them are not well prepared. So let's pray for those who are dying that they will be saved. Jesus said, "What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul in the process?" Let's pray for the dying. Let's pray for ourselves that we have the grace of a holy and happy death. Today being Saturday, my friends, I'd like to give you a brief Marian reflection, then we'll enter into the feast day that we celebrate today. Today we celebrate the feast day of two saints that are apostles. So today we celebrate the feast of Saints Simon and Jude. But before doing that, I'd like to give a Marian reflection, a Marian invitation. I think it's incumbent upon us to strive to form a good, integral, complete Mariology. Good, integral, and complete Mariology should have the two D's. We should have both devotion and doctrine. Devotion without doctrine can degenerate into sentimentalism. Whereas doctrine without the devotion can become very dry or arid. So we have to have a harmonious blend between the devotion and the doctrine. And the means by which we can arrive at this would be a prayerful reading of one of the greatest Marian masterpieces ever written, by the great Saint Alphonsus Liguori. Saint Alphonsus Liguori, a doctor of the church, lived into his 90s. Was a very prolific writer. And he had great devotion to Our Lady of Perpetual Help, which is deeply rooted in the Philippine culture, Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Saint Alfonso Maria Liguori wrote many works, but his spiritual masterpiece, the spiritual masterpiece of Saint Alfonso Maria Liguori, is what is called the Glories of Mary. I recommend that all of you, sooner or later, get a hold of this spiritual masterpiece and that you read through it. I'll give you a motivational summary of this spiritual masterpiece, hoping that all of you one day would get a hold of this masterpiece and read it. It's a very good habit to do spiritual reading every day. But most especially spiritual reading on Saturdays in honor of Mary, to get to know Mary better and better. The Glories of Mary is basically this. Saint Alphonsus takes the prayer we say at the end of the rosary, which is the Hail Holy Queen. And he takes this beautiful prayer, the Hail Holy Queen, and he explains it just a word at a time. And the way he explains it is that he takes the best resources to explain the presence and the power of Mary in the world. He takes from the Old Testament and then the New Testament. Then he takes the fathers of the church, the doctors of the church. He takes the saints and the popes. And it's somewhat like of a Marian compendium, if you like, of the greatest writings on the Blessed Virgin Mary up into the 1800s when he lived. So by explaining the glories of Mary, he's manifesting the power of Mary, but also the great mercy that Mary has. Going on to say that God is justice and mercy, but Mary is pure mercy. Then after explaining the word, then he'll give a story which illustrates the idea, or the point, or the word. I'll give you one of the stories that he used. It's a story of a young man that had great devotion to Mary. Especially Our Lady of Sorrows. And this young man would go every day to greet Our Lady of Sorrows to the statue of Our Lady, who had her heart outside her body and seven swords piercing her heart. So one day he goes in front of the statue and notices that there's eight swords piercing her heart. With tears in her eyes, he stops in front of the statue and enters into conversation with Mary. And he asks her, "Why do you have eight swords piercing your heart rather than seven?" And she says, "Because what you did last night." He committed a serious sin that last night. And she invites him to be reconciled with God. So the young man gets the cue, goes into the church nearby. There's a priest in the confessional. He goes to confession, receives absolution, comes out, and then he goes to visit the statue. He notices the statue once again only had seven swords. So by his confession, he was able to pull out the eighth sword from the heart of Mary. Great story. It's a great story. So then the Saint Alphonsus takes a word, a story, then he'll end the idea with a prayer to Mary, a colloquy to Mary. A colloquy to Mary. So on this Saturday, the last Saturday in the month of October, which is dedicated to Our Lady of the Rosary, invite all of us to get in the habit of doing some good spiritual reading every day, but especially spiritual reading in honor of Mary, some Marian book on Saturdays. So I'd like to move from our Marian reflection to the saints that we celebrate today. Today, my friends, we celebrate two saints at the same time. Two saints at the same time. The two saints we celebrate at the same time are two apostles. So the apostles we celebrate today are Saints Simon and Jude. Simon, also known as Simon the Zealot, to be distinguished from Simon Peter. Then Jude, to be distinguished from Judas Iscariot, his name is Saint Jude Thaddeus. So Saint Simon and Jude today, two of the original 12 apostles. When we say the word apostle, apostle means, it comes from Greek and it means to be sent out. The apostles were sent out to preach the gospel, the good news. So as always, there's a lot to share with you and our Perseverance family. But I'd like to start with sharing with you the gospel today. The gospel today is taken from St. Luke, chapter 6, verse 12 to 16, those five short verses. What I'd like to highlight in the gospel today are a few things. It says that Jesus went up to the mountain to pray. How often in sacred scripture do we have mountain experiences? Can you name them? Climbing a mountain is very important in biblical theology. We have Abraham that's climbing Mount Moriah, where he's asked by God to offer his son Isaac in sacrifice. You have Moses. You have Moses. Who climbs Mount Sinai, where Moses will receive the Ten Commandments. You have Elijah. The great prophet Elijah he flees to save his life from King Ahaz, as well as the queen, the wicked queen Jezebel. And Elijah climbs Mount Carmel, where he encounters God, not in the wind or the storm or the fire or the earthquake, but he discovers God in the gentle breeze. Then we'll have our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who climbs the mountain of the Transfiguration with three of his apostles, Peter, James, and John. And he's transfigured in light. And Jesus talks with Moses and Elijah. So we see the mountain in the Bible has great importance. One last idea on the mountain. St. John of the Cross, the mystical doctor of the church, whose feast day is December 14th, who's also the spiritual director, Teresa of Avila, like St. Alphonsus Liguori, he's a doctor of the church. He's able to write some spiritual masterpieces on mystical theology. Among which would be the Canticle of Love, commentary in the Song of Songs, the Dark Night of the Soul, where he explains the different stages that we have to go through before we arrive at mystical union, the purgative way, the illuminative way, the unitive way, the fire of God's love that has to burn away all that's not pleasing to God. And St. John of the Cross also wrote another spiritual masterpiece called The Ascent of Mount Carmel. In this, St. John of the Cross compares our spiritual life, giving an analogy, our spiritual life can be compared to climbing a high mountain with all the challenges that are present. All the challenges that are present in climbing a high mountain. So Jesus climbs the mountain, and often the climbing on the mountain is symbolic of the effort we have to make to arrive at God, but also a mountain experience often is an experience of an encounter with God, a mountain experience. So the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 6, verse 12, points out that Jesus went up the mountain. And he says he went up the mountain to pray. How often in sacred scripture do we see Jesus in prayer as well as Jesus teaching us to pray? Starting off his public ministry, we find Jesus going to the desert. Or in the desert, Jesus spends 40 days and 40 nights in prayer. Then in the Gospel of St. Luke, we see Jesus. When he's baptized, he's seen in prayer. Also, the Gospel of St. Luke, known as the Gospel of Prayer, before giving the Our Father, which is our Lord's Prayer. Jesus is in prayer, then the apostles say, teach us to pray as John taught his apostles to pray. There before dying in the Garden of Gethsemane, we see Jesus in prayer. So constantly throughout the Gospels, we encounter Jesus Christ wrapped up in prayer. So that's a motivation for all of us in our Perseverance family. Let's try to grow in our prayer life. That's right. Let's make a concerted effort in our lives to grow in our prayer life. Let's make this proposal today. Lord, teach me how to pray. Give me the desire to pray. Motivate me, Lord, to pray. That's a beautiful prayer. That is a beautiful prayer. So before our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ chooses the 12 apostles that he will choose to be with him, as his collaborators, as his friends, as his associates. Jesus prays. But St. Luke specifies this. It says he spent the night in prayer to God. That's very important. It wasn't just a few minutes, but rather Jesus spent the whole night in prayer. Imagine a good 7 or 8 hours he spent in prayer to his Heavenly Father. Spent the whole night in prayer to his Heavenly Father. Last night we had Eucharistic adoration the whole night. People were coming and going. Some people spent several hours in prayer in front of the Blessed Sacrament. I started off by praying the Mass, celebrating the Mass for these people. Then they spent the night in prayer, in imitation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, how do we apply this to the gospel and our lives? It's this. Not only do we have to grow in our prayer life, but another point from the gospel today is the following. The choosing of the 12 apostles to be our Lord's collaborators and friends, the apostles who will extend the preaching of the kingdom of God to the whole world, this was a very important decision. So for us, before we carry out very important decisions, before we carry out very important decisions in our own lives, we should In imitation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, imitation of the Lord, we should spend time in prayer. Let's follow the example of Christ. And this should be highlighted. The more important This should be highlighted. The more important the decision, the more time we should give to prayer. We'd even like to add this, related to the virtue of prudence and the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is called counsel. Is the following. We should also seek counsel before very important decisions. I've told parents that have their teens that are heading toward the end of their high school years, that before they help your children to decide where they're going to go to college or the university, perhaps you consult me or some adult that can shed light on this all-important decision for your kid. Because sad to say, and this is the truth, many young people, young adults, they actually, excuse me, they actually lose their faith, or their faith is weakened when they go off to college. So making that decision as to where they're going to be going to study is very important. Very important. So the more important the decision, more time we should dedicate to prayer as well as consultation as to where we should send our young adults, our teenagers. Excuse me. Wow. So Jesus, he spends the whole night in prayer to God. Let us imitate our Lord to grow in our prayer life. But also praying before very important decisions. Praying before very important decisions. So it says that after Jesus spent the whole night in prayer, he called his disciples to himself. He called them to himself to be with him. To be with him. And he chose 12. Certain numbers in sacred scripture are important numbers. 3, 7, 10, and 12. 12 is important because you have the 12 tribes of Israel. Now you're going to have the 12 apostles. He called the 12 and he named them apostles. As we said, apostle means to be sent out. And they would be Simon. So you got Simon Peter, and today we've got Simon the Zealot, two different people. Simon, whom Jesus would change his name to Petra, or Peter, which means rock. And Jesus will say that I call you rock, and upon you I will build the church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against you. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So Peter is the prince of the apostles, and he'll become the first pope. And he chooses his brother Andrew. So Peter and Andrew are brothers. Peter and Andrew are brothers. And they were fishermen on Lake Galilee. Both of them, Peter and Andrew, will both die. They will both die being crucified. Simon Peter will crucify under the reign of Nero. And Peter will be crucified upside down, because he did not feel he was worthy to be crucified the way Jesus was. He felt unworthy. So he asked to be crucified upside down. And there the remains of St. Peter are under the main altar of the Basilica of St. Peter, where I was ordained a priest 37 years ago. Thanks be to God. Andrew was his brother. Andrew means manly, masculine, and it means strong. Andrew also was crucified, but in the form of an X on ropes. And according to tradition, he hung on the cross for a couple of days, where he was preaching his last homily from the pulpit of the cross. What a strong man. So Jesus chose these brothers, Peter and Andrew. Then he chose James and John. So two groups of brothers, Peter and Andrew, James and John. And those two groups of two, they were fishermen. Jesus would call them to no longer be fishermen, but fishers of men. This you can find in Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, after they catch the huge catch of fish, Peter falls at the feet of Jesus and says, Lord, leave me because I'm a sinful man. Jesus says, do not be afraid. Now you'll become fishers of men. Let's pray that we would form our children to love each other, but especially to love God. So James and John, these are the pillars of the Catholic Church. Then we have Philip and Bartholomew. Philip will go on to say, Lord, show us the Father, and that's enough at the Last Supper. Jesus says, Philip, have I been with you so long and you still don't understand? Whoever sees me sees the Father. Bartholomew. My friends, Bartholomew is also known as Nathanael. Very rarely will our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ give compliments. But he did with Nathanael. And all of you can see the movie Chosen by Jonathan Rumi has a lot of very good points. They really get to know the humanity of Christ. I think it's done a lot of good. A lot of people really have gotten a lot out of Chosen with Jonathan Rumi. And there was a scene of Jesus choosing Nathanael. Nathanael Bartholomew, Jesus looks at him and says, behold, you are an Israelite without any guile. In other words, a man of great sincerity and truth. Now, if you ever have the chance to go to the Basilica of St. Peter, there is a majestic statue of St. Bartholomew and Nathanael in the Basilica of St. Peter. And it looks as if he's holding a scroll, somewhat like this. He's holding a scroll, kind of like this. But it's not so much a scroll, but it's actually his skin. The reason being is because Nathanael or Bartholomew, all of the apostles died as martyrs except St. John the Evangelist. But St. Bartholomew, St. Nathanael, same person, was flayed. When they say flayed, he was skinned alive. But he didn't die. So eventually he was decapitated. Can you imagine being skinned alive like a potato being peeled? Can you imagine that? What courage and strength the apostles had. These apostles were not Jewish priests, nor were they scholars. Nor did they have degrees in philosophy or theology. They're very simple, common, ordinary men. Sometimes pretty slow, pretty dull. Our Lord would preach and they would say, Lord, explain it to us. Our Lord speaks about the leaven of the Pharisees and they say, we forgot to bring bread. So not very intelligent until the Holy Spirit descends upon them. So we have Jesus choosing the 12 apostles, and today we have the apostles Saint Simon and Saint Jude. Saint Simon and Saint Jude, we really don't know too much about them. But a few details. Simon is also known as the Zealot. And there are two interpretations. One interpretation could be that Simon the Zealot was very zealous in wanting to, after the descent of the Holy Spirit especially, very zealous in wanting to be with the Lord and bring the Lord's teaching to others. But also Zealot was a political group. that were violently opposed to the Romans. And the Zealots wanted to free themselves from the dominion of the Romans. And some of the Zealots even used violence and force to attack the Romans so that they would be freed from the Roman dominion. So those are two of the interpretations of the word zealot. Zealous for the Lord, for the cause of the Lord, but also the political group called the Zealot group. Simon would eventually die as a martyr. Now, St. Jude, important that we do not confuse St. Jude with Judas Iscariot. This St. Jude would be St. Jude Thaddeus. A couple of details on his life. We have him at the Last Supper. He blurts out this question: Lord, are you going to reveal yourself? Are you going to reveal yourself to the whole world? He asked that question to Jesus Christ. Will you reveal yourself to the whole world? Certain sense. We have the word Catholic, Catholic. And of course, our Lord will, and He's going to do it through them. After the descent of the Holy Spirit, Jesus will send the apostles throughout the whole world. So it's a very interesting question that our Lord will use them after the descent of the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel to the four corners of the world. Jude is also the apostle that's responsible for one of the letters in the New Testament, the letter of St. Jude. Perhaps some of you didn't even know that there is actually is a letter of St. Jude. There is. It's one relatively short chapter. And you what you might even do is, in honor of Saint Simon, Saint Jude, you might open up your Bible, find the letter of Saint Jude, and read through it. And I think you're going to be able to get many graces how this letter written 2,000 years ago is very applicable to what's going on in the world today. This wave of immorality that has descended on humanity, you're going to read this in the letter of St. Jude. Both, according to tradition, both St. Jude and St. Simon, according to tradition, they both died as martyrs on the same day, shedding their blood for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Saint Jude is also known as the patron saint of the impossible cases. Many people have made novenas to Saint Jude in their difficulties, known as the saint of the impossible cases. So let's pray that we would become modern apostles. that like St. Simon, St. Jude, that we would try to spread the gospel news to the whole world. And I'd like to invite all of you to share our message. A way in which you can be an apostle is to share our message to the whole world. May we become modern apostles. Fulton Sheen says, first come, then go. And I'd like to give you my priestly blessing. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.